We know there are many choices in internet radio, and the staff and host of LA Talk Live would like to thank you for choosing the internet's hottest destination for the most eclectic sound and invigorating talk. This is LA Talk Live. We are more than just talk.
Corners of the globe and broadcasting to you live from the studios of LA Talk Live. Happy holidays, happy Kwanzaa, happy Hanukkah to everyone in our 150 countries worldwide and to our 12 million tuners. I mean, viewers and listeners, when I say that, happy holidays to you all. Welcome to a very special holiday edition of the Marijuologist, the world's only show that gets to the very root of the medical cannabis industry. Throughout California and the globe, it's holiday season. I'll bet you we're going to see a boom. We're going to see a Trump bump in cannabis, I promise you. I know we are. Let me back from the mic a little bit. We're going to play a little something from Leap, as we always like to do. Get your mind right. Get your body set. Get your spirit in motion. We're about to do a live holiday episode of the Marijuologist right here on the world leader in internet broadcast, the one and only LA Talk Live and the America Talk Live broadcast system, where it is more than just talk. Do not go away. It is 420.
Executive director of a large reentry coalition in Lancaster County, Pennsylvania. It's called the RMO. And we've been doing work for about 10 years as a collaborative effort, bringing together people in the faith community, the criminal justice system, players, and the human services sector to really address issues facing individuals who've been in prison, address the issues when they're coming out of prison, think about what are the impacts on their families. And I have to say, 10 years ago, I really didn't know anything about the criminal justice system. It was out of sight, out of mind. I didn't pay much attention to it until it hit the evening news. And of course, the stories that are in the evening news are never the good stories. But I had an opportunity 10 years ago. I met a woman who had worked inside the state prisons in Pennsylvania for over 30 years. And she was looking for somebody to write a book about her work in the Pennsylvania state prison system. So I agreed to write that book and started going into the prisons myself and sitting down with incarcerated men and women and hearing their stories. And I started to learn a lot about what brings people to prison, some of the reasons that people are incarcerated, some of the reasons that they stay trapped in the system. And what I was learning just really shocked me. And I reached kind of a point where I had to somehow get involved. So after my book was published, I got made a radical midlife career change, got into this reentry work. And some of the important work that I think really needs to happen at this point going forward is we really need for churches to understand how the criminal justice system, how the war on drugs, how the criminalization of addiction and mental health issues is tearing apart individuals and families. One of the things that I've learned in this journey over the past 10 years is that because we've passed so many laws that criminalize addiction and mental health issues, we are then locking up people who are addicted to drugs, people who have significant mental health needs. And in the process of arrest and incarceration and solitary confinement and many of the things that happen inside a prison are so traumatizing that it actually makes their conditions worse. So I really feel like the churches have an opportunity to become a prophetic voice to speak out against the criminalization of addiction and mental health issues, to begin advocating instead for treatment instead of punishment for these conditions. And also, I think the churches need to speak out about the prison industrial complex. There are many for-profit entities that are now making money off of keeping large numbers of people locked up, and that's a really significant concern. One of the things that has been talked about here at the Ecumenical Advocacy Days Conference is the Healing Communities Initiative. That's a national training framework for the faith community. It was developed originally by the Annie E. Casey Foundation. And it provides a real important perspective and awareness for churches about the criminal justice system and all of its impacts. But then more importantly than raising that awareness is it engages churches in thinking about how they are going to take action. How can we change the culture within our own congregation to help people who've been caught up in the criminal justice system, but who maybe because of shame and stigma haven't even been able to talk about that at church? How can we make a culture that makes them feel like they can reach out for help, they can talk about their experience, and instead of facing judgment and condemnation, that they would be greeted with acceptance, with a willingness to show mercy and compassion and forgiveness, that their families would be cared for while they are locked up and when they are returning home. So I think those are some of the things that we can do as people of faith. Educate ourselves and then be willing to speak up, speak truth to power in these systems that keep people trapped and enslaved really within this criminal justice system.
Over the years working with the prison justice group in the state of Vermont, I've come to the conclusion that you can't look at problems of incarceration without looking at our policy of drug prohibition. I think that as a church that cares about public safety and public health, that cares about the welfare of individuals who are addicted to drugs, we do ourselves and them and society a disservice if we don't look at the absolute abject failure that our policy of prohibition has wrought. We need to have this discussion.
The war on drugs has absolutely nothing to do with drugs. It's about power, it's about control, coercion, it's about money. We've had almost 100 years of drug prohibition. We've had almost four decades of the war on drugs. We spent a couple of $1 trillion on interdiction alone, yet there are more drugs at cheaper prices on our streets than ever before. My organization, Efficacy, and LEAP, we all favor bringing these drugs inside of the law, meaning we're looking to legalize, medicalize, and decriminalize all these drugs to cut the access that our children have for these drugs.
Now, I spent 30 years as a police officer in the town of Manchester, Connecticut, and retired as a captain down there. And for most of that time, I was either a detective or a commanding officer of the detective division, under which was the Triton Narcotics Task Force. And I managed that task force. And what we were doing was arresting our neighbors and our friends, because in our town, we only had about 20,000 people at that time. And everybody pretty much knew everybody. That accomplished nothing, as far as I'm concerned. All it did was hurt these people in terms of their future jobs, service, etc. We haven't accomplished anything by law enforcement. We cannot arrest our way out of the drug problem. It cannot be done. We have 2.5 million people in prison today, more than any other country in the world. We're not talking about the ones who are also on probation, the ones who are on parole, the ones who are in halfway homes. And we're certainly not talking about the children who are left almost without parents because their parents are in prison. And who is taking care of them? We're not talking about violent offenses here. We're talking about nonviolent offenses. As a police officer, we were taking kids out of elementary school who were dealing drugs in elementary school. Ask any teenager, if you gave them $50 and sent them into the local high school, how long would it take them to come back out of that school with drugs? I'll guarantee you that it'll be less than 5 minutes they'll come out with drugs.
They can just walk out of the street, 12 midnight, 3 o'clock in the morning, and purchase illegal drugs, but they cannot go and purchase alcohol or cigarettes.
Now we're talking about the good of our youth, but at the same time, we are leaving in place a policy that is resulting in them pulling guns out and shooting each other to death over who's going to sell drugs on this corner.
Poverty may cause a little, but most of the people that use these illegal drugs are not in poverty.
Why are the gangs? Where are the gangs? They're in the poverty. They're in the communities with the greatest poverty.
But the gangs aren't using. The gangs are selling. It's the white kids who are dying of overdoses. It's not the gangs. The gangs are using this money to buy weapons.
I know before alcohol prohibition, people were saying the same things and that we would become a nation of alcoholics. It didn't happen. And we're not going to become a nation of drug addicts if we legalize drugs.
As a police officer, I have seen it. It isn't working. What we're doing is not working. All the police are doing is creating job vacancies. If I arrest the dealer that's on your street corner, all that's going to happen is that the kids in the area are going to say, whoa, there's an opening, there's a job available, and they're going to fill that slot.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's right.
What I would say is, all right, let's not legalize drugs. Let's also take alcohol and tobacco off the market and make them illegal because we know how many people are dying as a result.
Well, we know that didn't work. Prohibition didn't work.
But we're doing the same thing with drugs.
Why are we doing the same thing with drugs?
They related a lot of the drugs that are illegal. They related those to minority groups, whether it was Chinese, African Americans, or whatever. And so fear, white people. They made them illegal because they were in people's minds associated with bad people.
Right. You're wrong in it. It's fear and the intellectual dishonesty that fear promotes causes this particular problem. On one side of the equation, you have the drug dealers and the drug cartels. On the other side of the equation, you have these multi-billion dollar bureaucracies set up to fight the drug war. If we legalize drugs, both of these bureaucracies are going to go away. If, in fact, we arrested and incarcerated whites for illegal drug use, we wouldn't be having this conversation because there would literally be armed insurrection in the streets. Instead of 2.5 million people, now we're talking about 12.5 million people. Connecticut has almost an $800 million prison budget, with 70% of the people there for drug-related charges. Now, if we legalize, medicalize, and decriminalize these drugs, now we're talking about $500 million coming out of the prison budget that can go for prevention, that can go for revolutionizing our education system.
I think we began a discussion here that I hope will continue. I think we've sowed some seeds and gotten people interested in the idea.
It's been a religious conference, and the thing that I think about it is most striking is the Sermon on the Mount, when they talk about and we become what we hate. And through drug prohibition and the war on drugs, we have surely become the things that we hate.
Cliff brought up the Sermon on the Mount, and certainly the approach that Jesus took when he talked about hurting people never included condemning them, sending them off to jail. To think that we as a society treat those hurting people by calling them criminals, punishing them, and
trying to incarcerate them out of their addiction. But really, it's hard to imagine that we could be so short-sighted and so uncharitable.
Let me see it.
Intelligent words from our good friends over at Law Enforcement Against Prohibition, and we wanted to give them some recognition this weekend on our very special episode of The Marijuologist. And this is our holiday episode. You know, I talked about a little Trump bump that's probably likely to happen with the cannabis industry. I'm a little concerned, I have to say, about the position that Donald Trump may have on cannabis and its continued safe and legal access. But the fact of the matter is, as long as we got people like LEAP on our side, and if you want to go to their website, go to leap.cc, leap.cc, and there they give so much intelligent voice to our challenges as a nation as it addresses safe and legal access to cannabis and other narcotics. I mean, we've been fighting this war for so long now, and yet the idea that we've lost every round of this fight is quite disturbing. I don't know how else to describe it. It just is an absolute lost war. And at some point, we've got to come to terms with this as adults and recognize that we have to take a different approach to this topic. We're going into 2017. California has voted to legalize. You're not legal yet, as I recently learned. I was out with my good friend and co-executive producer, you know, a couple of producers hanging out on the hip scene, being cool, and we decided we would go out back where other people were smoking cigarettes and think, okay, we should be fine smoking cannabis here as well. Much to my surprise, I was informed that, well, cannabis is not legal in California yet. I mean, when I was approached by the security. And I was confused, I have to admit. I felt ignorant, in fact. I am not up to speed on what the law says now about legalization of cannabis, but this young gentleman informed me. And so what happened in the end is we invited him to come by on the show. And in 2017, as we move forward with our dialogue, we're going to have him on the show. But for now, I want to swing the mic to my esteemed colleague, Equator Wolf, who joins me as always here on The Marijuologist. We've got some special secret guests coming through. Mm-hmm. I will ask Equator the Wolf to take it over from here as I make some adjustments here in the studio to accommodate our guests. Ecor, you're the man on the street. Tell us what's going on, man.
Thank you, Rich. This is Ecor the Wolf, the roving reporter, Wolf on the Howl, Wolf on the Prowl, out there in the world of the cannabis industry. You know, got that newscaster's voice. Yes, and I've been out there on the grind. And no, but actually, man, you know, I stay out there roving and on the grind, and I run into so many different cannabis situations that it's a beautiful thing, and sometimes it's not so beautiful thing. So, you know, we'll discuss how it goes both ways in this world where you go, you take the good with the bad. But I've been seeing a lot of dispensaries close down, and I'm also in the process of opening up my storefront within the next at the top of the year, I should say, probably at the end of January. I'm looking to open up my storefront, and I've been looking at a lot of these different ones that are closed down, and I have been doing research and have to find out why these particular dispensaries got shut down. And there are different stories and different reasons why. You know, there's not no one reason, but you know, I've learned a lot of more information about the law and, you know, legalization and how the paperwork has to be like completely, completely in order and compliant and not just some seller's permit. And, you know, you open up for 3 to 6 months and all of a sudden you get this citation or, you know, they run up on you, you know, run up in there and take all the product and shut you down, you know, perhaps go to jail or not, just shut you down and cease and desist. But these things are happening, you know, or it's politics involved where landlords are upping the prices or they're seeing what's actually going on. And so by them knowing what's going on as far as the money concerned coming in, the donations, I should say, then they'll get a little greedy, a lot of greed involved. So there are many different levels of situations that are going on, you know, as far as the not so good side. I don't want to call it bad, just say the not so good. And but the good side is it's still getting legalized and it's, you know, it's becoming more and more legalized. And we just have to be more patient and wait it out. By like year 2018, it should be all the way on the floor wide open. And until then, we still have to be very compliant. I suggest everybody still go get your recs, because it'll keep you protected for the most part. And be very, very careful how you purchase and leave what from the, you know, the different collectors with your product. That way that you can stay compliant and just get to your safe zone and partake in your meds. So those are just different aspects, and, you know, with the goods, with the bad. And like I said, you know, and there's still more erecting collectors that are opening. Like I was speaking on it, that there are some that are closing. A lot of them have closed now. But I have to make sure that my paperwork and everything is in order, so I won't have to deal with any of that situation, you know. All the only thing I'll have to deal with is a landlord getting mad because I ain't pay my rent, and I don't plan on no landlord getting upset with me for not paying my rent when I have donations coming in from the great product that I will have in there. So I deal with some nice companies who have some great product that are backing me as well. Teaming with me, I should say. Not backing me, but teaming with me.
I got to say, that's like woe to me because,
whoa,
you know, it is one of those kind of situations where I thought that the industry had, you know, kind of changed its position on this. And I really believed that there was an opportunity for folks to begin to grow their business. Mm-hmm. I still have to stand by the belief that inevitably someone like a Donald Trump, who will in fact become the 45th president of the United States of America, will want to make a difference as to how our medication is accessed.
Right.
With that, let's go through the break. I'm going to take a moment out and get our cameras adjusted.
We also have the lovely Illumina.
Illumina.
AKA Illumina in the building.
We'll be joining us on the mic. She seems a little shy. I'm not sure.
I know. I don't know why she's acting like, really.
That's
like,
all right.
Exactly. Okay, we just got to warm
that's
up.
That's all right.
We call that foo-fooing. I have a niece that lets you do that when she's a baby.
That's all right.
Just to like get around the family and then you know, have to like warm back up to the same family she saw yesterday.
All right, let's get to the break. We'll be back. More from the Marowologist special happy holiday episode. Do not go away.
Yes.
In 14 of those years, I worked undercover in narcotics. I retired a detective lieutenant from that job. But when I retired, I felt very bad about my role in implementing what today I feel is not only a failed war on drugs, it's far worse. It's a self-perpetuating and constantly expanding policy disaster. And there's no way to fix it. There's no way to patch it up or repair it. We got to end it. We got to end it like we ended alcohol prohibition in 1933. When I went in the state police, it was 1964. That picture in the upper left-hand corner is a picture of when I graduated that year. And right underneath it is a picture more or less of when I graduated from their narcotic bureau. I went into narcotics in 1970. That was the beginning of the war on drugs. When I joined the state police in 1964, we had 1,700 troopers and we had a 7-man narcotic unit. always seemed perfectly adequate for the job we needed to do. 6 years later, we had exactly the same numbers. And it was adequate because when we started the war on drugs, we really didn't have much of a drug problem in the United States. What little drug problem we did have was mainly soft drugs, drugs like marijuana, hashish, some LSD, psilocybin, the mushrooms, the mind-bending drugs. You know, the hard drugs, such as heroin, cocaine, methamphetamine, were virtually unheard of back then. Certainly unheard of compared to what they are today. And if you go back and you look at the statistics from 1970, you'll see that the likelihood of anybody dying that year in the United States as a result of the drug culture was less than the likelihood of them dying from falling down the steps in their own house. It was less than the likelihood of them dying from choking to death on their own food at dinner. But we started a war on drugs. So you got to wonder, what was really the purpose behind this, right? In October of that year, thanks to this funding policy from the federal government, we went from a 7-man narcotic unit to a 76-person narcotic bureau overnight. All paid for by the feds. And this was replicated across the whole United States. Now think about that. When you increase the number of cops with one job to do by 11 times its size, you set up a great deal of expectation. Expectation with us in that coming year was that we were going to make at least 11 times more drug arrests than we did the year before, and we were literally off to the races. That's how this thing became a numbers game with the police. It's all about numbers. After 2 weeks training, they had the 76 of us line up and count off 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. Every third person became an undercover agent. I was one of those three, so that's where I spent most of the next 14 years of my life. When we hit the streets, we were supposed to arrest drug dealers, and that was really hard because, as I just said, there weren't many drug dealers around. They weren't in... Certainly in their suburbs, they weren't in rural America, they weren't in our schools. So instead of targeting us on drug dealers, they targeted us on young people, folks like you, people in college, people in high school, or in between. And when I would weasel my way into these small friendship groups, groups of 10 or 15 young people, come Friday night, they're out of school for the weekend, or if they're working, they're off work for the weekend. Somebody might say, hey, you want to get high? And if nobody said that, that was my job. So if anybody took me up on that offer, then one of the friends who had access to the family car or some other way to get to the city would go around to the others and say, hey, you want to get high tonight? Some might say, I'm studying for a test Monday. I'll catch you next time. Others might say, yeah, you know, while you're in the city, pick me up a couple joints, will you? Or they might say, you know, I hear there's some really good blotter acid out there. If you run across any, pick me up a hit of blotter acid. One dose of blotter acid, LSD. When they'd come to me, I'd put my order in for that same tiny amount of drugs. We're talking maybe $5 worth of drugs. They'd jump in the car, off they'd go to the city. An hour later, they'd come back and they'd hand those things out to their friends. When they handed it to me, they became a big-time drug dealer. Because that's what we labeled them. And that is what stuck. And I'd stay in that group until I got every single friend in the group. It was really easy to do because these people weren't drug dealers. They were young folks doing what we used to call dipping and dabbing, experimenting with drugs, and then accommodating their friends. They weren't making any money on this. They weren't even getting their gas money back for that trip to the city. So the second night, that person didn't want to make the run. Second night is person B, and third night is person C. And I would stay till I got every single person in the group. And I might be working 10 of these little friendship groups in different suburbs at the same time. So very quickly, I would come in with cases on a lot of people. About every 2 months, I'd come in with maybe 100 people that I'd had cases on like this. We'd have a big raid. 5 o'clock in the morning, we'd swoop into their neighborhoods with hundreds of cops, and we'd kick their doors down and drag those people out in chains. When we got them all down to the police station, we would have already alerted the reporters to be there with their cameras and snap their pictures and the perp walk and splash them all over the front page of their local paper, destroying any credibility, any respectability that these young folks had. When we got them all lined up against that back wall, my boss would come out. And he'd say to those reporters, "You see that? You see that? There's 100 major drug dealers we took out of your community. This is the worst thing that has ever happened in America. This is going to destroy society as we know it. And your only hope is that thin blue line of police. We need more money so we can hire more police. We need faster cars and better equipment and radios and guns that shoot a whole bunch of bullets and bulletproof vests. We need harsher laws. We need mandatory minimum sentences. We need 3 strikes, you're outlaws. We need. And the reporters would go away and write horror stories, scaring the public to death. And the public would read those stories and say, give it to them. And then we'd go out the next year and do even worse. And we've been doing that now for 44 years. Every year, worse than the year before. Now let me tell you about those young folks. What happened to them? Back in 1970, we only had one law about drugs. Wasn't like it is today. That law said, it's illegal to distribute a controlled dangerous substance. And then it gave you a big long list of those substances. There was not even anything in that law that said any money had to exchange hands. Well, when Mr. Clinton was smoking but not inhaling was exactly when I was doing this to those young people. And he was college age at that time. Well, let me tell you, if I would have infiltrated his group, it would have been curtains for Mr. Clinton. You know, drug use is a very social thing, especially soft drug use. 6 folks get up in a circle, spark up one joint, take 2 tokes and hand it to the person on the right. And it comes around the second time, and people are getting high, and they're not really concentrating on what's going on too much. So the second time around, the person hands me what's now a roach, and I grab that thing and act like I'm what we used to call bogarting, like I'm going to smoke it all myself. But what I'm really doing is I'm knocking the flame off the end of that and sticking what's left of it in my pocket. Because that night, I'm going to submit that as evidence that the person who handed it to me is a major drug dealer. So if Mr. Clinton had been in that circle, it wouldn't have mattered whether he inhaled or not. The mere handing of that joint to me would have confirmed that he would never be an attorney, much less the President of the United States. So with that one law, since it was only one law, everybody was being sentenced exactly the same. 7 years in state prison. 7 years. Now they all had to serve a third of max before they could come out on parole. So 2.5 years after each one of these raids I had, another 100 young folks were coming out of prison. What were they going to do? We'd snatched them off the streets in the prime of their life when they're trying to get their education. They don't have any education. And if they did have education, who Who the hell's going to hire them? They're dope dealers. That's what we said they were. So what are they going to do to feed their families, huh? What they're going to do is they're going to turn right back to the drug culture, the very group we say we're trying to save them from. Only now they're going to become real, honest to goodness, drug dealers. And for every new real drug dealer, you got to have a whole bunch of new real drug users. So every one of those folks is out there actively recruiting younger people to pick up those needles and become the next statistic. And that, folks, is how this became a self-perpetuating, constantly expanding policy disaster. There's no way to fix it. We have to end it.
Lieutenant Cole, is that what I should call you, Lieutenant Cole?
Just Jack.
Jack? Jack will be all right? All right, Jack. Ending prohibition. So you just get, drugs will be available to everybody, everywhere. That doesn't seem like a sound idea by a cop.
Well, the problem is that today drugs are available to everyone, everywhere, because today we have no control or regulation over who's going to get the drugs. People who control and regulate illicit drugs in the United States are the criminals, and they haven't done such a good job for us. So we say, let us take back that responsibility. Let us control and regulate these things. Let us set age limits to keep our children from getting a hold of these drugs. Let's get them off the streets. You know, our kids for the last 30 years have said in every government survey it's easier for them to buy illegal drugs than it is to buy beer and cigarettes.
Mm.
So that doesn't make sense to me. Why don't we make it at least as hard for them to buy heroin, cocaine, or methamphetamine as it is to buy beer and cigarettes?
So you think 18 years old is a good age to be able to buy methamphetamines or cocaine or heroin?
We don't think any age is a good age to buy any of these illicit drugs. Nobody at LEAP wants to see one additional drug abuser in the world. And if we thought that that was what was going to happen from what we're doing, we just wouldn't be doing this. You got to remember, we're law enforcers. We spent our entire careers fighting against drug abuse, and we haven't changed our mind about that at all, Mike. What we've changed our mind about is what is the best way to reduce drug abuse. And the best way is certainly not the war on drugs. We want to do four things. We want to reduce death, disease, crime, and addiction. And sadly, all four of those categories are made infinitely worse by the war on drugs itself. The only way you can end these problems that we've had now for 43 years of the drug war is by legalized regulation of those drugs. Only legalization will take them out of the hands of the criminals, end the violence. Only legalization will reduce deaths by, for instance, overdose. Once we regulate these drugs, nobody has to die of an overdose of drugs. I lived 14 years on the streets with these people undercover, and I can tell you right now, nobody dies because they shoot more and more dope. They die because they simply don't know how much that tiny package of powder they're buying is really the drug and how much the cutting agent.
I don't know, it seems like you're giving everybody an excuse now that it's going to increase the number of drug users. It's going to make it more available for them to use them. And now you talk about the smaller dose or whatever, they're going to be able to use all. We're just going to have like that Walking Dead type of movie will be realized in America.
Well, actually, if you look at the statistics from any country in the world, you find that every country, including states in the U.S., where they've done anything to reduce some of these repressive laws, they have less people using drugs today than they had before they reduced those laws. Let me tell you about Portugal. There's six countries in the world where they have reduced drug use by decriminalizing all drugs for anybody, any adult, 18 years old and older. Portugal was the first one to do it, so they've been doing this for 12 years. And of course, the drug warriors like yourself or me counseled them before they changed in 2001, don't do this. This will cause chaos in your country. You'll become the drug tourist capital of the world. Nobody will dare walk down your beautiful beaches because of needles sticking out of the sand, right? Mm-hmm. Well, none of that happened, Mike. What did happen was drug use in every age category went down. But the biggest drops were among the youngest people. So for children from ages 13 to 15 years old, drug abuse declined by 25%. For young people between the age of 16 and 18 years old, drug abuse declined by 22%. Those are really significant figures. And in the United States, for instance, in every state where they've passed medical marijuana laws,
yeah, I want to ask you about that later. The
use of marijuana among the teenagers has declined, not gone up.
You got to be thinking about a lot of different things there, but why not just fight for decrim? You want a decriminalization. You want this across-the-board prohibition for everything. If Portugal's so successful with a decriminalized effort, why not just duplicate what they did?
Why not? Why not, indeed, Sian? Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to the world's only show that gets to the very root of the medical cannabis issue. And in fact, now, safe and legal access across the board. Medical, social, political, any way that someone who wants to use this incredible plant that grows naturally from the earth called cannabis, any way that they want to access it. Well, you know, the idea is let's give them safe and legal access. What the heck?
Put your headset on.
So, you know, I'm with it. Are you with it? Well, if you are, thank you for joining us. Obviously, that's why you're here on our very special holiday episode of The Marijuologist with yours truly, Richard Carr, my esteemed colleague, Equator Wolf. Got to give that up. Known for such shows as The Wolf's Den, heard each and every first Friday at 8 p.m. Pacific here on LA Talk Live. And, you know, we've got other shows. 2017 is going to be a blessed year for us. Despite how I personally
feel. Dollar year and beyond.
Yeah, man. I'm going to keep it. I'm a wax a little political here.
The $2 year and beyond.
I'm feeling like I'm going to do what I need to do no matter who the president is. Because I feel at this point, we are on our Mickey Ficky own. Yeah, man.
Believe it. I mean, what can they do to us anyway as a race that they haven't been doing to us? We have endured so much anyway that all we do is just smoke a little herb, kick back, get your mind right, and we still push forward towards the goals that we always set in our race and keep it moving.
Or
it's still a loving race.
Or so. Even in the words, in the immortal words, I should say, of Tony Montana.
Yeah.
What can you do to me?
What can you do to me?
That Castro hasn't already done. So you can't do nothing to us, man.
Nothing.
We new to this. We true to this. Nothing you can do to this. And we're going
to
keep.
We ain't new to this.
The movement going. We're going to keep the message out there. We're going to keep communicating to our fellow advocates, patients.
Yeah.
And whether you're recreational or otherwise, we want to appeal to you to stay tuned to The Marijuologist in 2017. We're going to work a little bit harder, a little bit, to build more programming on the network. And if you yourself would like to be a part of it, you can hit me up directly at ecor@latalklive.com.
I-K-K-O-R
at latalklive.com. And, of course, I am Richard@latalklive.com. R-I-C-H-A-R-D
I want to send a shout out to Jane Green out there in the building.
Yeah,
she called in. And I don't know if she's still on the line right now, but
we got somebody on the
line. She's so loyal and so dope with it. You know what I mean? And she's still out there?
Jane Green, are you
Jane
there?
Jane Green, are you there?
I am in the building. I'm here, guys.
Girl.
Jane Green going
what
to be live.
Though, mama?
Hey.
How are you?
Welcome to the
show. Like, she's like our roving reporter out there. You know what I mean? Our roving cannabis reporter out there, you know. I hit her up earlier and asked her to call into the show, you know, because I know she's always out and about, out in the world somewhere. She could be on the moon, as far as I know, you know, because she travels.
Mm-hmm.
And so I do.
Yeah, she does. And so I said, well, you know, call into the show. And she did. And I thank you for that. And happy holidays to you.
Indeed. Happy holidays.
And I know, exactly. And I know that she has more knowledge and some things to talk about, especially with her own product as well, Jane Green products, and the whole cannabis legalization situation that's been going on since we've had an election going. You know, we haven't spoke to her since. And,
well, let's talk about Jane Green and refresh our tuners out there.
Who Jane Green is.
Who's Jane Green? What is Jane Green? And a little bit about yourself and your background.
And how can they get some Jane Green in their lives?
Awesome. Well, guys, my name is Tanjanika. I am the CEO of Jane Green, and Jane Green is a cannabis-infused skincare line. I currently offer a beard oil and beard balm, and we're already talking about expansion in 2017, so I'm really excited about the products that we're about to add to the list. And so I am a videographer, author, all that good stuff, and just keep up with all things cannabis because cannabis is my lifestyle. I'm that person.
You know, I got to say, I must have been inspired by the last time you were here. You've been a guest on The Marijuologist because my whiskers on my chinny chin chin are beginning to sprout. And when I shaved today, I thought to myself, you know, maybe I should just leave it all on. But I got the sides and I got the neck, so I don't look like a homeless dude. I still could, but I did the best that I had to offer. Anyway, all that said, I'm growing my beard out. I think I'm going to do it.
And yay, so do it.
I've got to do it now.
Really?
Do it, so I think I got to get with you and get some of that beard balm.
And it smells so good, man. It lasts on you. I don't have a beard, but I put it on my face and my head, and it just smells so good. Mm. It just lasted so long, and it smells so like manly.
Okay, now I feel some kind of way that I didn't get any.
But you got the other.
Sorry, Richard. I got you though. Don't worry. I didn't know.
You gotta get me now because you know I'm growing my beard. Really. We've got the very lovely Illumina here who joins us on the mic tonight. Let me give her a rousing round of applause as well.
Illumina.
All right, hold on. Audience, wake up out there. We're boring you.
Come on.
Put your hands together and make a righteous noise for the lovely Illumina.
Hello.
She's sitting right across from me, and she knows most of the time she's ever seen me, I'm whiskerless.
you are usually.
I didn't even notice.
Yeah.
It looks like a baby's bum.
Yeah. I am growing my hair out now because I want to, you know, just create a different look, get the Van Dyke going on. So I need you to hook me up, you know, and make my life better and easier.
For how long? How long are you going to?
You asked me that. I don't know.
I might go. We're old to see, right?
I could either go Bin Laden or Santa Claus, Lynn. I don't know.
Probably.
Well, whichever direction you go in, Jane Green can assist. So just stand by for some oil and some beer balm, and I got you guys. I got you.
Very good.
So where are you? I know you're on the world.
Where are you reporting from?
Where are you reporting from?
I'm actually in LA. I just got back. The Emerald Cup, and that was amazing. That whole experience. I was able to compare Northern and Southern California, just the movement and the differences and all that stuff. And so I just got back from there, and like now I'm just winding down for a year, y'all. I'm just trying to chill and just get ready
about
for 2017.
Yeah.
Well, before you wind all the way down, give us a rundown on the differentiality of the Northern and the Southern.
Oh my goodness, it was like two complete different worlds. A lot of times in Southern California, we want to put on these big events and we want to make sure that, you know, everyone comes out and they're dressed and they put all this money into like the booths and all that stuff. It wasn't like that in Northern California. It was all about rustic vibes. People were down to earth. They are all about the flower up there. Right. It is literally about making the best quality plant that you can make up there. And when I tell you, I was actually... I did a booth up there, and I was talking to every contestant that submitted flower into the contest, and I was able to get samples from them.
Oh my God.
I tell you, it was so pure. I have so much cannabis on me.
I am jelly. Decided that you'd pick tonight not to come by.
Right.
How about that?
Now I'm real.
She covered it all the hostel.
Real hoist.
All them northern lights that she had up there.
Well, we'll see you again because, you know.
You got to get the bomb from
You're not going to smoke it all to yourself, are you? I didn't think so.
Definitely going to try.
She said, watch me.
Yeah. All right. Well, save us a pinch of it at least, okay? So
we can
fellowship with you through that sacrament that you were blessed with
So that had to be a great experience, though, that Emerald Cup, man. You probably ran into so many connects and people and just, like, expansion.
It's not, yes, and so many, what I'm kicking myself about is the fact that I didn't have my own booth with my own products. It was so many men up there with beards. I'm going to kill it next year when I have a booth. So I'm so excited about that and just the transition that's about to take place, the people that I linked up with, and, that I was able to network with. Yeah, things are happening. So for next year, I'm really, really excited about Emerald Cup.
Nice. I'm excited for you.
So earlier on in the show, when we first got started, once we got the dialogue open, I mentioned that I think there's going to be a Trump bump. We might as well accept it. And it's a thing that they're using on Wall Street to talk about how Wall Street, how the stock market has skyrocketed and reached near record trading volume. I think the same thing may stand to happen in the cannabis community with businesses having or being released from the regulations. Another topic that Donald Trump's real big about, releasing the regulations on businesses, particularly small businesses, so they too can grow. Hopefully that will play over into the cannabis industry, and those regulations will further be released and relaxed to the degree that we may well see a Trump bump in the cannabis industry as well. Are you saying that perhaps some of what you saw at the Emerald Cup is emblematic of that or representative of that? Or would that be your estimate? Do you think we're going to see a boom happen in 2017, particularly here in California? Would you be willing to go out on a limb to speak to that?
I would actually go out and say that, but it's not going to be because of Trump. I don't think. I think it's going to be because of the community and because of the tireless efforts of the people and the activists in the community. It's one of those things where we can't turn around. We can't go back so much. Over 54% of Californians voted for this. This was something that you can't sweep this back under the rug, no matter who's in office, that type of thing. But I also think that Trump is not really necessarily the person that we should be focused on. I think it's his advisors and the people that are around him that are going to be the people that really are position to sway things either way in our committee. And so we have to really keep a watch on them.
Only because he's dealing with the Billionaire Boys Club now, and they all are, you know, they have a lot of voice in our country. It's not about these millionaires. It's about
and that might not be a bad thing, because the fact of the matter, the cannabis industry is a $1 billion industry just in California alone. Then you got Oregon. Then you got 20 some other states that have gone either legal or medical access.
Right.
So it is poised to be. So again, Maureen, I would ask you to go out on a limb, take point on this mission. Do you feel that the cannabis industry is poised to be a $1 trillion industry?
Oh, absolutely, easily. This is going to be probably the first $1 trillion industry that we're going to see. This is going to expand beyond borders and boundaries. And the problem, the only thing that's going on in California that counties really have a ban on whether you can cultivate outdoor or not. Outdoor is really off the table except for if you get a license. And so if you're cultivating those 6 plants that you're legally allowed to grow in your house, you're going to start to see a barter system probably. You're going to start to see people really grow and grow for their families, grow to maintain their lifestyle. Those are the type of things that you're going to start to see an influx of. And those counties that have bans, they won't be able to see any of the money from the tax dollars. So that's going to sway them in a different direction and a different mindset as well. Right. So you're absolutely going to see a boom, and this is absolutely going to be a $1 trillion industry, especially with California involved being the 6th largest economy in the world.
Say it again, sister.
Very well said.
Well, that's looking into 2017, and having E-Quarter Wolf here on our dais tonight and his experience working with the community-based cannabis collectives and co-ops that are starting to spring up, some of which, unfortunately, are losing their way. Mm-hmm. let's talk about a strategy for folks considering the cannabis industry. I've met several people. I recently met a banker who, you know, I guess he smelled it on me and said, hey, you know, I'm looking to get into that business. And I'm like, dude, I don't get down like that. but bottom line being that he was thinking about investing in the cannabis industry, but from what angle? From what perspective?
Right.
So the question, having Ecor here on the desk with us tonight, having you via Skype, we even have the lovely Illumina joining us, and we will have her illuminate on this topic. Isn't it cool? Yeah, it's pretty cool. Yeah, and she's cute too. She's real cute. Let me put some spotlight on you over there. Yeah. All right. So that's it. What course should someone take if, and I, this is a bold question, so I'm going to lay it out to the entire panel and to the audience. If you want to give us a call, 323-473-3100, 323-473-3100. You're tuned into The Marijuologist, the world's only show, gets to the very root of the medical and, you know, social cannabis issue. Yeah. And we discuss the social, political, medical, economic, and ecological impact of cannabis on California and the entire globe. So for those of you just tuning in, to give you some sense of direction. What would, if you were to be an investor, and perhaps you even are, and we've got Ecor and all those people, what's the better thing to do? Should you open up a storefront collective? Should you cultivate? Should you enter into a barter system, or should you branch out into some of the ancillary industries of the cannabis community, and that be, you know, making bongs or pipes or growth products, nutrients, all those kind of things.
Novelties.
If there was one place you'd start to put your foot in, and I know you've got your foot in the industry as well, but beyond, let's say, skincare products, if you really wanted to get down to the medical side of it, or at least the, you know, psychotropic side of it, meaning that the stuff that gets you high, I'm sorry, I'm trying to be politically correct here.
Right.
What would you enter into? Would it be a collective? Would you open up a collective right now, if nothing else? That took a long time to ask that stupid question.
No questions are stupid.
Detailed.
Go ahead.
Very elaborate.
Yeah.
That's dope. That's a great question. I think that it's it comes from a couple different angles. You can come at it like, what's your capital situation? Like, if you're an investor and you can open a collective, why wouldn't you? But also, with it being federally illegal, that hinders a lot of investors from coming into the space. And if they come in, they're only looking for ancillary businesses that don't touch the plant directly. So when I was in Emerald Cup, I met this gentleman. It's called True Terpene is the name of the company. And they have a gummy. They have a mango gummy. When you consume mangoes 30 to 60 minutes before you consume cannabis, it amplifies your high. It makes it last longer and it makes you higher.
Mango.
So he has a gummy just made of mangoes. It doesn't have anything psychoactive in it, but he's assisting the cannabis industry, helping it to go further and move further along. So you can do something and think outside the box and not touch the plant at all. And that way you're safe, your money is semi-safe, and you're able to get a return on your investment. But whether you choose to get involved in a dispensary where you're touching the plant or not, this is like the only industry that has compound annual growth, over 22% compound annual growth. Mm-hmm. And so there's no other industry that's doing this. So I would say, whatever you're going to do, do it now. Get involved now. Touching the plant is going to be so taboo after a while. We need software. We need security. We need so much for this industry because it's such a baby industry and brand new. We need so many things. So whatever you choose to get involved in, I say do it now. Is what I say.
Let me take a moment out.
Apparel to, food.
I wanted to give a shout out to L. Whitney Beattie, who is the founder and CEO of the Apotha Carry box. That's Apotha, C-A-R-R-Y, the Apotha Carry case, which is a luxury item for the high-end cannabis user.
I've been trying to get over her. Where is she?
We'll hook you.
I'll link you up with her.
I need two boxes. I'm trying to get her box.
I'll link you up with her.
Shout out to her and tell her call me.
I'll link you up with her.
Let's make that happen. This is a way that we are, in fact, a small marketplace for businesses to tie in, network, and collaborate. You know, it's like a think tank or brain trust in here, because there's so many talented people who bless these mics, present company included. And that also means myself. And, you know, we're all, you know, good thinkers, independent thinkers. We are, in fact, visionaries. Yeah. We are, in fact, patients and recreational users of this incredible, mighty plant and medicine. And we're not ashamed of it. We're advocates the whole nine.
Right.
And we don't get high and sit around and play video games.
Magic and music.
We
glue and shit.
Not at all.
Elevate through the plant and ideate
and motivate
when we're together and get active. So, you know, we represent this new era of awareness when it comes to cannabis in America, particularly because this is one of the last places in the first world countries that are still struggling with the notion of, if a person wants to harm their own body, let them do it.
Right.
Somehow we've gotten past the notion as a nation that if you want to smoke a cigarette, go right ahead, pal, light them if you got them. If you want to go down to the local liquor store, and particularly in a state like California, a very liberal state, you can buy booze all day up until 2. What I never understood is, why can't you buy it from 2 to 4? Why are you to tell me that after 2 o'clock I can't go get me a nice little Chardonnay or fine, frisky, young Cabernet?
Or some Ripple.
Who the hell are you tell me I can't go up in there and get me some Rot Gut
some
after 2 o'clock to 4 o'clock? So why do I have to take 4 hours off? Yet the country still allows us to buy booze all day, even in our supermarkets. You know, CVS just stopped selling cigarettes, and I'm so proud of them. But boy, the aisles are stocked with the better price alcohol all day up till 2.
Wow.
I don't get it.
Well, Jane,
we're so conflicted in our country, you know, in terms of how we address our issues of what is sickness, what is health, and just a part of what someone decides to do with their life.
Right.
You know, I feel free, but you're right. We're not completely free.
Not at all.
You know, but nonetheless, I didn't mean to go off on that tangent.
And speaking, and back to the apothecary box, Jane Green, she has, it's a new and improved box as well, and it's way
That's
better.
Right.
It's a lot better than the other box, too, so I most definitely
And the first box was bomb, right?
So it was. Nice. Yeah, most definitely.
The first box was incredible.
And I most definitely link you up with her, so don't even worry about that. I got you.
It's a great Christmas.
Oh, thank you.
Got you.
So 2017 is what, Igor?
Oh, that's that dollar and beyond year, baby. It was that, it was that in 2016, and it's then I told you that, and it's beyond, and we steady keeping it moving. So them dollars going to be rolling in. We're in a good industry, a great industry. Green Crosses is getting ready to be erect even more outside of Mobile. It's getting ready to be a storefront, and you'll see more apparel, and I'll be ready to come strong. I got a whole, and I have a strong team, and it's going to be a beautiful thing, man. You know, and we're going to include definitely the marijuana that's involved in LA Talk Live and the whole family.
And Jane Green Products as well.
Jane, most definitely. Yes, and I was scared getting to that. We got all. I got so many different people that I know who are in great positions that we are going to align ourselves and position ourselves to just, like, leverage and build and grow with each other. And it's going to be a beautiful thing. It's going to be a beautiful thing. As long as everybody's minds are right and they're in the right state of thinking. You know what I mean?
I'm sorry.
Go ahead.
Lots of different opportunities out there, though.
Lots of opportunities, man.
Got to get your mind right on it.
Right.
Get your mind right on it.
You know, don't just sit around buying up ounces and sitting back and smoking it and laying on your ass. Start ideating.
Exactly.
It's going to come to you.
One of the greatest things I ever heard about cannabis that helped me resolve my own sense of guilt for what they used to call self-medicating. Mm-hmm. No, I'm not self-medicating. Even though this is a medicine, I like using it.
Right. Exactly.
It wasn't because I needed no medication.
I
could buy $10 worth of cannabis because Tylenol is $11.99.
No.
Right. No, I like cannabis.
And
so I'm not self-medicating. I'm smoking it because I like to smoke it.
And I'm still going to buy some Tylenol for a headache or something.
If I get one.
If I get one.
But all that said, these opportunities abound way beyond just getting yourself a dub sack and sitting around all day. And
are the days of old. You know,
Man. You touching, for you millions of people out there in America who are touching cannabis From now on, every time you touch it, you ought to think of it as as cash money.
Oh, yeah. Oh,
as a barter item.
A tree that keeps on giving.
Right.
Keep on growing.
You could get some junk weed from the hood and that's filled with old stanky seeds. Mm-hmm. And take them seeds and plant them in your ground. You'll grow the same stanky weed, but little by little, you can start cross-pollinating those seeds with other better seeds that you can get. And before you know it, you could be a grower and a provider of cannabis to what I think is going to be the multitude of collectives and co-ops that are going to open up to give people access from the hood to Hollywood.
Mom and pop stores, you know?
Absolutely.
Jane it's a Green great products business. Will be over there in
but
the
Jane
hood.
Green, I love what you said, and I love what you represent with your product line.
Yes.
And that you don't have
Thank
to touch
you,
the flower. Yeah, you could cook the oils. You could make beard products for my growing beard, and trust me, it's going to be a burgeoning industry
for
there
my
as
bald
well.
Head.
For his bald head, and for folks all around the globe who are looking for ways to not use the paraffins and the waxes and
right.
all the poisons
all that
are in it, junk.
Exactly. Yeah.
So
chemicals.
You walk the walk, toxins. And along with talking the talk, that's what we love about you here when you come on with us. We
thank
miss
you
here you. In the studio.
She's a warrior.
Oh, thank you. I want to just make sure you guys are aware that after 5 years, in 5 years, 22,000 grow facility. I mean, 22,000 square foot grow facilities will be in place. The license for that will come on board, and that's where the big whatever you want to say, big pharma, big tobacco, big whoever's coming, big is coming. So that's how long you have, guys. And 5 years is literally like tomorrow. So again, I encourage you guys to do your research. Whatever you're doing in your regular world, your regular life, you can absolutely transfer those skills over into this industry and thrive just as much or even better. I really want you to, you know, get outside that fear, get outside that comfort zone and really utilize the resources that are available to you between ECOR and Richard and Illumina. I love that name. And
thank
so
you.
Everyone that's involved right now is here to help. So reach out to us we're here for you.
If you're touching that green, you are touching the green.
And
it's
if you're rubbing,
green,
and rubbing that, and you got to be rubbing that Jane green.
Ah, put the Jane green up on you. Get it all up on you.
Get it up on you.
Jane Green, we love you, girl.
Love you, mama.
I appreciate y'all for having me. Thank you so much. Y'all are awesome.
Next time, send us some banners. We can plug you during the breaks and all that stuff, but we'll talk about that moving into 2017. We're here to support you, and thank you for supporting us once again. The lovely Jane Green.
The lovely Jane Green.
Thank you. You guys have a great day.
No doubt.
Bye.
All right. Happy Merry Christmas.
Yeah, man. All right. So what'd you say? We go to the break and whatnot, man?
No doubt, man.
Let's take a little break, man. It's 5:28. Let's take a 5:20 break. What the heck? We're going to make them up ourselves as we go along.
On the 20s. We're on the 20s, y'all. Be back on the 20s.
All right. Yeah, we'll be back. Don't go away.
Green.
I have a brick. I sit and think. One blunt, two blunts, or was it three? Can't remember if I smoked it all with company. Gotta admit the memory ain't nothing what it used to be. Oh, well, that's me. I need some weed. Can't hit the shop. It's too early. Oh,
if an emergency happened or something like that, the only thing I'm packing is food in a sack. Cause it's mandatory that I gotta be stoned. Like Ice Cube said, once again it's on. It's a fucked up feeling when you're California fiending. If you smoke blood, you know exactly what I'm meaning. Open up your jar when you trip cause it's empty. But the night before you could've swore you had plenty. With no connection, don't know what to do. So you try to drink a 40 as a substitute. But it doesn't feel the same as that Mary Jane. Creeping up real slow, marinating my brain. And I've been at the bottom feeling just like a peasant. Saving all my roaches and scraping up my resin. I smoke so much weed that I sweat THC. A day without herb, I can never let it be.
Oh, why did I give up? I'm here, Shalina. Give up. Give up. Instead of packing like a pack rat, I was acting like a fat cat instead. Can't believe I did it once again. A fucked up habit that I got. I always do it to myself. I'm always smoking on my pot. I got no options, I could call the women from the streets. But it's a Monday and it's 6 a.m. before his peak. That's fucking weak, I need some weed. A long morning, THC free. I can't believe I got no marijuana for my brain. I always do this cause I need a blunt, my fucking name. I need to go at 10 a.m. I pull up to the front, guess what? They're open.
Let's go for a ride. and we do what we do. You bring the red, and I bring the blue, and we make the purple, the herbal, herbal. Stimulate my mind some, let's see verbal. I don't think I ever went one day sober. I wake and bake in the morning like a straight soldier. I'm blazed over till my brain's in a straight coma. I treat it like it's a race in the Daytona, and feel like how you feel when you take Atomas. I smoke a blunt to a roach and I'm still smoking. Riding this bitch till the fucking wheels broke. There's no puff puff, it's just puff pass. Cause if I puff puff, I'm handing you just that. That's how it's been ever since I was 18. I pack up another fresh bowl and take green. There's no babysitting it, we baseballing it. Cause all that talking does is waste all of it. I break down a bunch of weed and got the swisher broke. Roll it up, light it up, man, we fix the smoke. One blunt, three blunt, five blunt, smoke. Hot box in the car, rolling up the window. Six bowls, eight bowls, nine bowls, smoke. Hot box in the car, smoking up the endo. Bumping oldies, hot box in a Monte Carlo. I take a hit from the split, say goodbye to sorrow. Blazing cigarros, get high like I'm Dave Navarro. Cause when it comes to smoking weed, I'm a general. You talking about smoking blunts, I smoke 10 of those. And break down a 50 bag of Kush and a bowl. I smoke that Kush, you only find it high time centerfold. I'll be smoking on this donkey shit with a kid. You feel like you just got hit by a monkey with a brick. The room's filled up with so much smoke, it blows the roof off. Cause I smoke like trains, I smoke like I'm Snoop Dogg. There's no babysitting, it's me baseballing it. Cause all that talking does is waste all of it. I break down a bunch of weed and got the swisher broke. Roll it up, light it up, man, we fix the smoke. One blunt, three blunt, five blunt, smoke. Hot box in the car, rolling up the window. Six bowls, eight bowls, nine bowls, smoke. Hot box in the car, smoking up the endo. Take a hit on the hour, every hour, for at least an hour. Unleash the power of the green rocker flower. I keep smoking even though there's no getting higher. Firefighters approaches cause they think my shit's on fire. I smoke a couple bags, switch it with some hash and goo. And smoke like the weekend on a Sunday afternoon. It don't stop 24-7 smoking some dro pot. Cause I smoke just like mechanical robot. There's no babysitting it, we baseballing it. Cause all that talking does is waste all of it. I break down a bunch of weed and got the swisher broke. Roll it up, light it up, man, we fix the smoke. One blunt, three blunt, five blunt, smoke. Hot box in the car, rolling up the window. Six bowls, eight bowls, nine bowls, smoke. Hot box in the car, smoking up the endo. One blunt, three blunt, five blunt, smoke. Hot box in the car, rolling up the window. Six bowls, eight bowls, nine bowls, smoke. Hot box in the car, smoking up the endo.
Joints at night, so
smoke two joints in the afternoon, and it makes me feel alright. Smoke two joints in time of peace, into a time of war. Smoke two joints before I smoke two joints, and then I smoke them all. She once told me, son, you be hard working. Mama, she once told me, son, you do the best you can. Then one day, I met a man came to me and said, yeah, hard work good, hard work fine, but first take care of him. Once in the morning, I spoke to Johnson. Smoke to joints in the video game. Smoke to joints in time of peace, into a time of war. Smoke to joints before I smoke to joints, and then I smoke.
Let's get back to work here, why don't we? Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to the one and only The Marijuologist, the world's only show that gets to the root of the medical cannabis business throughout California and the globe. I'm your humble host, Richard Gard, joined by my esteemed colleague, Ecuador. Getting a little tired, it seems like. I don't know. We're doing the break now. Anyway.
It's The Marijuologist.
Stepping away momentarily is the lovely Illumina.
The illustrious Illumina.
Yeah, she brought in some delicious smelling tacos.
Delicious delights.
And she's been offering them to me, and I'm about to finally give in.
Yeah, they were smelling
I think
good.
She ate them all, though, really, though. It wasn't but three of them, right?
She grabbed them all.
Yeah,
she
grabbed them all. It was like five of them. It was like five of them.
Word? There's a chance for me?
Yeah, there's a chance for you.
There's a chance?
It's a strong chance.
All right, cool.
Roll the dice.
Did you get some?
No, they were carne asada. I mean, carne asada.
What's asada?
You know the beef.
And okay.
I don't eat beef.
Yeah. Okay. As long as it ain't no pork in them.
Nah. Not carnita. No carnita.
Where'd you get them from?
They were homemade from her Asian friend.
Oh, I'm getting down.
Who was also a show. The last time I saw her, she was cooking some shit.
You won't be seeing me for long, ladies and gentlemen. Yeah. I'll be, I'm waving in Illumina. Get in here. get in there. Get in there, Illumina. No. Leave it there. Yeah, come on over. Yeah, what is she doing?
I don't know.
She's so confused tonight. I don't get it. Just sit down. Why don't you? What are you doing now? Oh, well, jeez. Okay. So, look, let's get back to the issue at hand, and that is the Marijuologist. It is our holiday special, And we are live in the studios, and we want to thank LA Talk Live and the America Talk Live Broadcast Network for giving us this opportunity to come and bring our holiday special to you. We started the show off tonight with, in fact, and throughout the night, we featured a lot of the message of law enforcement against prohibition. Hey, listen, it's the holiday season, as we said. It's Christmas time. That means Christmas. That we are going to go and enjoy ourselves and enjoy our families. Mm-hmm. I pray that you all enjoy your families. I hope so. We're going to enjoy some libations. Be careful.
Me and Buttons.
There's always Uber and Lyft. And exactly. We're going to enjoy our cannabis. Once again, be careful.
Be very Uber safe and out there. Lyft, and Lyft.
Right? So let's put that out there.
Or your designated friend that are very responsible.
That's right. So do not smoke and drive. Contrary to what you may think.
Do not be high and drive, right?
Yeah. Just don't do it. This Lyft and Uber are way too cheap. And who knows, the homie or the homegirl could be even cheaper.
Exactly.
Right?
Exactly.
Make a call this holiday weekend.
Right. Don't do it yourself.
Smoke and drive. Cannabis.
Definitely don't be drunk and drive.
Yeah. And drinking, come on, man. Go ahead and drink and drive. Go ahead and drink and drive.
Don't be drunk and drive.
No. Go ahead and drink and drive. Because you deserve that $5 billion fine they're about to put on your ass for being stupid.
And life
still
in jail.
Drinking and driving.
Still going
and
life in jail. Your ass go ahead and hurt somebody and kill somebody. Yeah, no. All because you want to be thinking you can.
Don't even. I mean.
I just follow the line.
Go ahead and drink and drive.
Just follow the line.
Still, do what you want to do.
If you're still that freaking stupid, then go ahead and do it. Because that way, it's one less driver on the road for me when I'm out there driving. But of course, I'm saying don't drink and drive. And if you're that stupid,
don't.
Good Lord.
And friends and family members, if you see your buddies.
What impact are we going to have on you?
And friends and family members, if you see one of your friends or family members that are drunk, do not let them strongly intervene. I don't care if you got to fight them and put them in a restraint overnight for being drunk. Do so. Because they're going to thank you later. Or y'all knuckle it out when everybody's sober up, and then they don't realize that, man, I could have killed somebody last night.
I like that.
Yeah, put them on camera. Put them on camera so they can see how they are before they leave out of there. So if they have any problems the next day, they're going to thank you. Like, man, thanks for showing me that video because I did wake up a little angry, not wondering what's going on. But look, man, you would have killed somebody last night. If you just sit back. Let's watch. Push play.
Exactly.
You know?
I'm liking this part of the show because I think it's important for us to put out there based on the nature of our topic, for the uninitiated, for the first timers, for people who may not be aware of the potency of not just the flower, but also the edibles, the medibles, as I like to call them. You must be aware. Someone gives you a brownie for Christmas, and hey, man, put a little something
in it.
Put a little First thing is, hold up, homie. What you put up in it?
Right. First question.
You know, first question is, you know,
what's the something in it?
Yeah, right.
Put something.
Well, you know,
up in it.
I put a little cannabis in it, and then you are, oh, cool, groovy, dude. And you're driving home, and like, man, I'm hungry, man. Let me
eat a
that turkey was good.
That cake now.
You know, let me grab a little bit of that brownie and,
it would taste so good. It's seasoned right. You know, it's all good.
Tastes like a brownie.
Right. And you start to eat more and more. Like, before you know it, you ate the whole thing, which you're not supposed to do.
Yeah. By then, you're like lethargic.
By the time like 30 minutes hit, and if you're still taking a lengthy drive, you're going to feel like the car seat is pulling you down. Gravity is just straight dragging you down. Because that's how heavy it's going to make you feel. And you're going to just be like lethargic. So don't eat the whole thing.
Don't eat any of it when you get in the car.
Let's
put it like that. Wait till you get home.
Unless somebody's driving you.
And hey brother. Hey, sister. Wait till you get home.
Right. It's not that
serious.
Don't abuse everything.
And you eat that brownie.
Because it's still yours.
As much as that brownie as you want. And you get in the bed. And by the time you wake up.
You're going to feel so good.
On Christmas Day. Or the day after Christmas.
Go to your Christmas.
Right.
Lord have mercy. You're going to have the best sleep you've ever had in your life.
Exactly.
Like a baby.
Wow.
Seriously.
So don't eat the thing.
I met my ancestors.
And the whole thing is, don't be in such a rush to eat it. You know what I mean? Because it's still yours. So you can, if you just have the patience to get home and then do it.
And let us also mention that size doesn't matter when it comes to cannabis because there are very potent gummy bears.
Dosages that are...
There are very potent...
Oh, yes.
Reese cups, candies, potato candy, chips,
Jolly Rancher type
beverages,
candy. You name it.
Sodas, pops, popcorn, very potent.
You could be like the little nerds, too. Oh, my goodness. You pop four of those things. Now, I've worked in many dispensaries. Well, you know, a few. All right. So from these dispensaries, I'm always given the responsibility to be the taste tester, which I volunteer
myself
for.
Give it to Mikey.
For.
He'll eat
right.
it.
Right. I know, but then, you know, it's also alongside with that. It's a little, you know, challenge, but it's a wonderful challenge to just, like, basically express how it makes
just
me feel.
Just a little herb.
Yeah, you know, so like, there's difference. There's difference that, like, each of these different things like make you feel
edibles.
And exactly
from edible
and
to edible.
Edible
right?
to
yeah.
edible.
To
yeah,
medible.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Right.
It could be pizza.
Man, like a
that's
straw
different
with
from,
honey
yeah,
that
exactly.
you just dip in your tea and like caffeine,
kaboom.
You know, decaffeinated and extra strong coffee. Like that's it's amazing. It's amazing to just write about it and it makes you feel differently. Each and every one of them, like from sativa to like hybrid to indica, it's awesome. It's just completely awesome.
And so that
Saving
means that
well.
When you're out there
Saving
driving,
lives.
Be careful.
Right.
Listen, cannabis is not going to necessarily, for the average individual, intoxicate you.
Nope.
With cannabis, my motto is, you don't get higher, you get lower.
How about that?
Meaning that the more you smoke, the sleepier
the downer
you get. Even with sativas. You know, there's a difference between indica and sativa. You know, and I like to say DayQuil and NyQuil.
Right.
Sativa's a DayQuil. Indica's a NyQuil.
Mm-hmm.
You know, how do you feel? What do you need? What's your symptoms? This can address it.
Right.
Which one will help you throughout that process of your day? That's
right.
basically it to me.
Exactly.
You don't have, it's not that complicated. It's DayQuil and NyQuil. Let's keep it real. All right. Now, that said, anything, though, that impacts or impairs or alters one's sense of normalcy, then be aware of that. And I want to take this conversation beyond just smoking and driving and also to the office party.
Mm-hmm.
Lots of office parties are going on right now.
Yeah.
And at the office party, someone like, yo, step outside.
Step
man,
on the
I
patio.
Got a fatty.
Got a fatty.
Right?
Go in the basement. Let's go in the basement.
It goes hand in hand.
You know, and if you who are listening amongst our vast audience worldwide, and you don't normally indulge, and now that you know not to eat every brownie someone passes to you that's infused with cannabis.
It's tough.
Let's talk about stepping into that other realm where you go outside with somebody and maybe they light up a joint or a blunt or a bowl or a vape pipe.
Right.
Now, let's talk about vape pipes. There's the pipe, the vaporizer that vaporizes flower, and then there are the oil-infused, fireless
vapes.
Vaporizers. That vaporize the pure oil, and you think, oh, I'm with the homie or the friends, and you step outside, and God forbid you've had a little alcohol first, because cannabis and the sugar from alcohol will really boost you. Wow.
That's why
you know?
Good to have cannabis first before you drink anything.
Helps keep the balance on the alcohol, the sugars in the alcohol.
People don't think that because you just because you know it's two things you're doing. It's like no,
right?
It's a chemical.
So we want to warn everybody out there, and if you're driving alone, especially, and you are out in a party, and you know your first instinct is to have some champagne or some eggnog that's infused with alcohol, and then your buddy or friend or a group pulls you aside and now they're passing a joint and you're not a regular
head,
you know, user. Yeah. Head, you know, be careful out there, man, because if you're there by yourself, man or woman, you've got to get home and remember Uber and Lyft. And then of course the buddy system, And to all those buddies out there, you know, be vigilant this weekend over this holiday season. Mm-hmm. Be aware that your friend may need you. Mm-hmm. If you go to a party with somebody and you see that happen, you might want to consider, you know, okay, let me stand strong and support that individual because I see how they're getting down. No judgment, but I want to be there to get them home safely at least. Let's think about each other this holiday season.
I heard the lady, and don't go on the roof by yourself and smoke. I heard the lady passed away, went on the roof, smoking some marijuana, and she didn't come back down. They couldn't find her for days, and then all of a sudden she's right above them, you know. And they said she always likes to go up there and smoke her trees.
Wasn't the cannabis, though.
No, it wasn't that.
Yeah, she ain't like choked
to death. She choked to death.
Oh, wow.
She choked to death.
Don't get seeds and stems in your weed.
Oh.
That's not funny.
Don't inhale too hard.
But we don't
inhale any smoke too hard, you know?
That's a good point, too. A lot of people roll their cannabis in, you know, brown paper called blunts, and that can be very asphyxiating. Mm-hmm. It can cause you to begin choking. Mm-hmm. More than you normally would off some good ganja. Even with the Rastas, you could blow some hardcore plumes with the Rasta boys.
With the Fanta leaf.
Yeah, man. And without, like, choking on it, you know. But if you are wrapping yours up in that brown paper called blunts, you start choking out because you are asphyxiating because you're not a cigarette smoker and you got both cannabis and burnt brown paper in your lungs and now you're choking out on the roof. Don't do it.
Nobody heard you.
Yeah.
God bless her. Rest in peace.
We got to send so much peace and love out to the world. There's so much great, beautiful charity going on in the world.
Everywhere.
Little girls, maybe four, but I know three, were found in an abandoned home today.
Wow. Alive.
Maybe a couple days ago.
Alive.
Left abandoned in a house that was absolutely uninhabitable. No toilets, water, showers, heat, nothing. Not even cable.
Where was
oh, my God.
What state was this?
What is this, a warehouse?
You said no cable.
I won't say. Yeah. Because I want to just give the good message.
Exactly. Okay.
And
because I wanted,
there was a 911 call.
The reason why I asked because of the severity of the house. Yeah.
I don't even want to identify the state because when I heard about it, I was like, "Why is it depressing?" But I just want to give the good message. And here's the good message: there was a 911 call placed by a Samaritan, a good Samaritan, and the police responded to that 911 call and found three little girls, three or something, and one abandoned in the house. Wow. Father, unfortunately, had been arrested and put in jail. And those kids were in that abandoned house by themselves for I forget how long. I don't need to give the bad news of it. It's the good news. Here's what happens. Cops come, take the kids to the grandmother who hadn't seen the kids in a couple years. Mm-hmm. Grandmother takes them in. Now the cops go. Cops. Like saying that word. Cops. Go and raise funds and charity for this family, to the grandmother. Mm-hmm. Clothes, toys, an abundance, and start a GoFundMe and raise $100,000.
Wow.
As they should.
That's
wow.
That is
think about that.
Valorable. Wow.
There's more good in the world.
There are.
We hear more about the evil because that
media.
Sells.
Media. What we were,
it's the media.
Yeah,
it's
media.
But there's way more good.
Programming and media.
So if there's way more good,
it's just that it goes unheard.
Wouldn't it make sense to get a piece of that good and then spread it?
Exactly.
Pay it forward.
Right.
Because
if there's way more good, then there's way more of that to share than there is of evil and bad stuff. Mm-hmm. So during this most important season, we call the holiday season, to people, do you know in Aleppo, Syria, a town that had suffered years of war and bombings, they finally are starting to evacuate the refugees from that city, or really the residents, and get them out of the danger zone.
Right.
And someone actually put up a Christmas tree. Now, this is Aleppo, Syria, a traditionally Muslim
The one that
country
was,
that was bombed repeatedly.
Right.
Watch the news if you don't know the term, the particulars or the specifics of the story. And I know y'all get this, but they put up a Christmas tree in a Muslim country. And it really is just now a symbol of, hey, y'all, time of year.
Open up.
Let's all just chill out.
Because that don't mean anything.
Acknowledge the tree.
It's
tree
a doesn't Christmas
mean anything.
Tree.
It's a tree with lights on it. It doesn't mean anything.
There's a reason we call it smoking trees now.
Believe it.
You know, there's a reason we engage in this sacrament of this plant.
The peace
to
sacrament.
Slow everything down just a minute. Why don't we?
To see more clearer with clarity.
Cell
feel me?
By cell.
Let's just take our time. Think about this, if nothing else. Do something unusually kind to somebody.
Exactly. My little kid put on the
something unusually kind, like
put on Facebook, paying it for yesterday. You know, and
don't
I did so.
You don't even have
don't even
to
think
talk
about
it.
Yeah,
I did
you
so.
Even,
you know,
doesn't have to
you know?
Exactly.
Yeah.
Don't even have to give out money. Smile.
Right.
Exactly.
Right.
And everybody.
There's so many ways of paying it forward. So many ways. Hold a door for somebody.
Do you know in this time of so much lack, just smiling at everybody you walk
the
by.
The effect that
it
makes.
Has.
Right. Right.
Now
exactly.
I have this new motto.
It's positive.
And I'm gonna leave y'all to it after this. I've decided to be the nicest man on earth. Now, I can't pay your car note. So please
don't
send
it
to
me.
I'm still gonna be nice.
I'm still
be nice to you.
Can't bail you out of foreclosure.
Or jail. I can't bail out of jail either.
The way my bank account works is I can't get you out of jail, just like what he said. And I don't need money
15. No.
To do this.
Exactly. It doesn't cost to be nice.
I can just walk to earth and do two things. Real simple.
Was right.
Smile
right.
At everybody that walk by me, who catches, whose eye I catch. Smile.
Right.
Simple.
That is, right.
Two is be the nicest guy.
That's
it.
That's great how you say whose eye I catch, because it ain't just like I'm going around.
Yeah, you're
all smiling.
Hold on. Yeah,
right.
You ain't got to just smile. Yeah.
Like, crazy, man.
If you catch the eye of another human being, smile at him. It's amazing the impact.
Oh,
you
yes,
have.
Yes.
Completely disarmed.
And if it's a man, exactly. Make sure you do it in a certain kind of way. You know what I mean?
It don't even matter.
Right.
You know,
right.
I see so many brothers on the street. I'm like, that's a big dude right there. I wonder if I can take him. I just look at him and smile. He didn't even know I thought that.
Exactly.
Right. Exactly.
It just completely humanizes
exactly
every experience that I have with human beings.
It does.
But also, just be the nicest person you can be.
And would you mind like talking more about that?
Meaning that if someone cuts me off, I'm like, no
just
problem.
Always
okay.
Be nice. Just
yeah.
Be nice to everybody.
When I walk across the street to the CVS or the Ralph.
Right.
Just always be nice to everybody.
I'm walking across
everybody.
The street. Someone will pull out into the crosswalk, and they'll
instead
look at me, and they'll feel so guilty because they'll look at me like, I'm like,
it's
no problem.
Okay.
No problem.
Don't sweat
that,
man. Just don't pull out. Though.
Right.
Don't
right.
Hit me because
right.
Then
exactly.
It's going to get ugly.
It's all about being nice to everybody.
Meaning I'm going to be splattered all over the street, and who wants that to happen?
So you're being the best guy that you could ever be.
Whatever happens to me, especially if I feel crossed or in some way offended,
right,
based on my own myopic perspective on life, I think to myself, just be nice, man, frick it.
Right.
And just keep stepping. Smile. Right. Sorry. My bad.
Exactly.
How you doing?
Exactly.
Excuse me. Sorry about that.
Mm-hmm.
It's hard.
Exactly.
Sometimes I'll be like, man, why
but
don't
you've done that before. This you haven't really tried this.
Oh, no.
Month.
I've been
right.
doing
I mean,
this. Yeah, I've been doing both of these things for so long, but it's been
very good
in the recent year that I've really looked at this as a practice,
right,
as a discipline, to say to myself, be the nicest person you
exactly
in the room. Fuck it. That's part of my language. I want to be the nicest person in the damn room.
And now one of my statements is if you do what's right, you ain't really, you have to worry about nothing. If you it's always if you always do what's right, you ain't got to worry about nothing.
Righteousness is not hard. Just do the right thing.
Just do the right
exactly.
thing. And you know what it
exactly.
is to be right.
It's
people
the holiday
know what
season.
It is.
Exactly.
Do the right thing.
People know what it is because it's a vibe. It's a vibration mm-hmm. of what right is. And you know it's right. you know.
Why don't we get some Christmas wishes in before we wrap out the show?
Yeah, it's a good wrap out right about now.
I'm channeling my inner Ed Sullivan. I want to thank all our special guests who joined us. Okay.
My inner Donald Trump.
You go Donald Trump, I go Ed Sullivan.
Okay, LA Talk Live, we're going to shut you down the first chance that I get. We're going to take all the blacks, all the Mexicans, all the Filipinos. We're going to put a wall up. No. We're going to put them there now. We're going to do it now. Now. Great. Shut up. Global. Shut up now. Hillary, shut up. You'll never, ever be president. I am Donald Trump. No, I don't want to live in the White House. No, I'll live in my plane before I live in the White House. Thank you. Ivanka, just please tell them. Yeah. Yeah, I date my daughter.
Oh. that swing me to the
down. He said you that. Have something you would like to contribute that before. To that and our that wrap before. Out moments here. He what would you before. Like to say, Illumina?
So with all of this, I'm gonna wrap it up with just
a rhyme?
Stay true to yourself. Stay true to yourself. Whatever you do to yourself first, it's not selfishness. Whatever you do to yourself first, you're able to actually spread that towards the whole entire globe naturally and organically. So love yourself first. You'll be able to love everyone, you know, just purely and genuinely. Enough with the cycle of pain. We know what that is. We know what that is. Just remember your energy, living in this physical world with mind, body, spirit, heart, you know, shall I keep going? You know all of those things. And each day you're learning a bunch of different information. And, you know, just develop all of those things that you're learning and keep waking up others. And keep loving one another and fulfill your purpose. Stop being afraid. Afraid of what? Afraid for what?
Well said. Oh.
Yes. Illumina. I can say more.
Illumina. Illumina.
I'm going to put it right there. Love, Mary Jane.
Lighting the way, ladies and gentlemen. I'd like to thank everybody for tuning in to the world's number one internet broadcast network, LA Talk Live, where we are more than just talk. We are radio. We are reality radio, handcrafted for your listening and viewing pleasure. We are LA Talk Live, and we are more than just talk. Thank y'all for tuning in to the Marijuologist with your host Richard Carr.
Man, I gotta tell you, I pulled this one straight up out the Dusties, man. The OJs. Man.
Woo!
What a classic, dude. You know, we normally end up with our Marijuologist song or something roster and
but it's Christmas boy. Time now.
But it's a holiday season.
You know. Yeah.
Wow, I like that one. All right, you said enough. I'm ready to go.
Let's go. We ready to go, ladies and gentlemen. God bless. Good night. Lady Illumina, Ecor the Wolf.
Ow! Everybody.
Next time, every Friday, 4:20, Marijuologist, LA Talk Live Broadcast Network, LATalkLive.com, and we out.
Thank you.
Be safe, be righteous, do something kind to your fellow man and woman.
Yes. Absolutely.
Just be cool. We'll see you next time.
Be careful. Be safe.
For your listening pleasure, this is LA Talk Live, and we're more than just talk. Stay tuned.